We've got a big show coming up in St. Augustine Hall next Monday night. It's called Ask Father Jack. And if you listen to a Blaze Radio, you probably heard the Ask Father Jack program. Well, we're doing an Ask Father Jack program on religious liberty, and we're going to record it live in here. So we need a big crowd that's really loud and raucous, and so it sounds, you know, crazy on the radio. But Father Jack will be here, as well as Dr. Kathleen Raviel, and they're going to be answering your questions. So you're asking yourself, how do I get my questions in? Well, here you go. You can submit your questions to askablaze@stmonicas.com, or you can call and leave a message with your questions there. So give some good questions ahead of time, and then join us 7:30 next Monday evening. So that's the 27th, right here in Augustine Hall, 7:30 for the Ask Father Jack recording. All right, as Ablaze rolls on, want to let you know about the upcoming schedule for Ablaze. Next week, we are here on the 26th. We are not here on the 5th. We're not here on the 5th because we have the parish mission starting on the 5th in the evening. So be here for the parish mission. Put it in your calendar now. We all want to be here that night. And for that reason, we're going to take the week off from Ablaze that morning. So we have the week off in 2 weeks, but then we're back on Sunday the 12th, and we'll be here, I think, through the duration or through most of Lent. So just keep that in mind. If you're here in 2 weeks for Ablaze, you're going to be a little lonely. So just keep that in mind. We're off in just a couple weeks. Finally, want to just update you on the social media slide and the social media things that we have going on. If you want to follow St. Monica's Ablaze program, you can do it on Twitter. You can do it on Facebook. We have the text notifications as well. If you text that to that, you can get the text updates that we send out every week. And you can also watch us on YouTube. YouTube's great. If y'all miss a week, you can go on YouTube and you can catch up on last week. You can catch up on what we did 2 years ago. We've got all of our programs there on the YouTube page. So youtube.com/stmonicasablaze. And also email. If you're not on our email, our constant contact email list, there are lists in the back that you can sign up for so you can, again, keep up with what's going on with Ablaze. So I think that's all the housekeeping notes that I have. Now we're going to get ready to bring up Father Jack. And if you've never been to Ablaze this morning, and I think most of us have, but I think there's a few rookies out there that have not been here before. We have 3 week series. This is the second week of the series, so this is the praxis week. This is when Father Jack, you know, in week one, he kind of introduces the new topic, and week two, the praxis, he kind of puts some meat on those bones and kind of tells us how we can practice and how we can kind of bring this kind of into our everyday lives. So week two, we're going to kick this off, and we're going to bring up Father Jack Durkin. Big hand for Father Jack.
Steve, awesome. The Holy Spirit is moving, so we want to allow the Holy Spirit to operate within us and not resist the love of God, which is that Holy Spirit. The will of the Father is love, and that love is expressed in the Holy Spirit to the Son, and the Son returns it back to the Father. And the Father, through the Son, has sent that Spirit of love within us, so that we can love God and we love neighbor. And we have to just be aware that that Holy Spirit's within us, and the awareness that the Holy Spirit is revealing God to us, that the Holy Spirit is sanctifying us, that the Holy Spirit is helping us to see in creation and the recreation and the order of grace the movement of God, that we discern where God is present and where God is opposed. And to discern spirits is to discern the movement of the Holy Spirit, okay? So these are great gifts, and we should avail ourselves of this. Experiencing and acknowledging the presence of the Holy Spirit, knowing God. That's what we're going to talk about, knowing God. I mean, think about that. Those of you who remember the Baltimore Catechism, what's the purpose of life? Can anyone tell me? To know, love. So if we don't know, it's the first thing they say, know, love, and serve God, okay? The goal is beatitude, to be happy, to have a life that's meaningful and leads to the ultimate happiness of heaven, to know God. And can we say that we know God well enough to reflect God to others? That there's an element that is both an intellectual knowledge, but also an effective awareness. where we know, God, that God is present in this situation and we're sensing effectively that presence of God in every situation. We should not lose the peace that Christ has breathed upon us in the Spirit at his resurrection. So let's look and see what we got here today. I'm trying to press this thing. I forget what direction I pointed. Over here. There we go. I just blanked it out again. Oh, I'm doing the opposite direction, I think. I'm doing something. Okay. Let's pray this prayer together. And we know how it goes. That's what we want to pray, yeah. Let's pray the prayer together. We do the first part, then the verse is me, the response is you. So let us pray in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and enkindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit and they shall be created. And let us pray, O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant us in the same Spirit to be truly wise and ever to rejoice in his consolation through Christ our Lord. Amen. And what's so wonderful is this prayer can be prayed before anything. Why not at the beginning of the day to stir up the gift of the Spirit? There are many things that want to contradict that spirit of truth and revelation, of creation, the goodness of creation, of sanctification. And the two things that attack us, the most dangerous things that attack us are anxiety and discouragement. All the other sins that we experience, the root sins even, what precedes those root sins? Discouragement and anxiety. If you're experiencing discouragement and anxiety, you're on the road to sin. What does God give us by his love? He gives us encouragement and he gives us peace. And we have to work from those two vantages, okay? So seriously, when you begin to experience anxiety, you know that that's not of God. That's not God's will. When you begin to feel discouraged, because remember, when there's something that you can't do that's out of your control, God's redirecting you. That's all he's doing. He's saying, guess what? This is out of your control. Okay, what do I do? It's kind of a simple thing. Believe me, when you're looking in one direction, if you begin to shift all the way around, you got like a whole bunch of other options. Okay? So there are points where you're going like, I need to stop looking at this thing over which I can't do anything because it's discouraging me. And I need to look around what I'm supposed to be doing right now. And then secondly, if you keep looking at what you can't do anything about, it will create anxiety. I promise you. Okay? And anxiety is not what you need. All that just breeds things like confusion, malice, anger, frustration, division, meaninglessness, darkness. And that's not really what we're about. Now, and let me just say, right now, if you think about it, you could list 10 things that you could focus on that would discourage you. I mean, think about it. Make a list of 10 things you could possibly look at right now that would discourage you. Okay? What I'd say is, if you can't do anything about those, just burn that piece of paper and stop it. It's like changing the channels. And just finding something that irritates you. It's just not worthwhile, okay? And the devil would like you to focus on those things you can't do anything about to avoid what you can. So let's review Ezekiel. Here's Ezekiel and what he says. Ezekiel 25 through 27 says the following. This might be my favorite passage in Scripture, which is pretty amazing because it's not in the New Testament. I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all of your uncleanness. When did that happen? Baptism. And from all your idols I will cleanse you. A new heart I will give you. When does that happen? Every time you go to Holy Communion. Okay? It's just the heart of Jesus, the flesh and blood of Jesus. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. When does that happen? Confirmation. Obviously, you receive the Spirit in baptism, but all three sacraments are indicated there. And this is what God has given to us. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will take out of your flesh the heart of stone and give you the heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you, this is the confirm part, and cause you to walk in my statutes and to be careful to observe my ordinances. Now, this is the whole point. Why are you cooperating with the Holy Spirit? He's the cause of every good thing you're doing. You got to, what you're doing is you're abandoning your flesh, you're abandoning your spirit, and you're living according to the flesh of Christ and the Spirit of Christ. You are decreasing and God is increasing in you. It's a very simple thing that God's calling us to do. Remember, what are the three things that God has given to us for us to live in holiness? They weren't things, they were persons. First of all, Last Supper, my flesh and my blood. Secondly, on the cross, behold your mother, Mary. Thirdly, he sends the Spirit at Pentecost. This is what has been given to us. This is how we live. These are the gifts by which Catholics operate. The personal relationship with Christ, his mother, and the Spirit that dwells in us so that we're children of God the Father and our inheritance is in heaven. So, Ezekiel, Christ's heart, Mary's Immaculate Heart, the fire of the Holy Spirit. When you look at Christ's heart and Mary's Immaculate Heart, you see fire coming out of it. What is that? That's the Holy Spirit, right? The sacraments of initiation, baptism, water from Christ's heart and his Holy Spirit, Eucharist, blood from Christ's heart and his flesh, confirmation, fire of love between the Father and the Son ignited in us. Why? So that we have a stronger communion with God, holy angels, and saints. That this exchange is a stronger communion. We go to Holy Communion to be united with God the Father through the flesh, blood, and Spirit, and the Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit, united with each other at Mass and every other Catholic on earth, in purgatory, and in heaven, and all the angels. So when we receive Holy Communion, this communion extends to the body of Christ and extends to God the Father. And this is a full communion. That's what you're experiencing at Holy Communion. If we actually knew what we were experiencing in the full knowledge, we would die. That's what we're supposed to do, right? Unless you die, you have to die and rise every time you go. If you're not really, seriously, it should be a death. I'm decreasing, Christ is increasing. Unless you deny yourself, denying yourself, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies. When you go into communion, you're that grain of wheat falling to the ground and dying. What's happening? You're rising in the death of Christ. You're rising in the power of his divinity. So there you are, stronger communion and then fruitful communication. We move from communion to communication. We move from communion at Mass to communicating that communion outside. What are we evangelizing people about? Guess what? You have a Father in heaven. Guess what? You've been redeemed through the Son. Guess what? You have a mother in heaven. Guess what? You have a Spirit that can guide and direct all your life so that you don't have to be worrying about these things, because instead you got the movement of the Holy Spirit and grace in your life. This is like, you don't have to be discouraged. You don't have to be anxious. Just get a life. What is life? The Lord, the giver of life. Who is that? The Holy Spirit. Simple as that. It's not a complicated. Believe me, our church is really not complicated. It's just that people don't, we actually don't listen. And we actually don't live that word. And so there you are. That's what we're all about. Very simple plan. Experiencing and acknowledging the presence of the Holy Spirit. Knowing God. How do we do that? The love of God is expressed. Let's just look at the Annunciation and the Incarnation, right? When the Annunciation occurs, the angel speaks to Mary. There's also the Incarnation, which is the taking on of flesh and blood by the power of the Holy Spirit of Jesus, the second person, right? So what we have is, if you look at this, it's very simple. What do we have happening? We have the Holy Spirit happening. First of all, look at this. At the Annunciation and Incarnation, love as sanctification. Love is that expression of the Father to the Son, which is the Holy Spirit, and the Son to the Father. What do we have? Hail Mary, full of what? Grace. She's sanctified. She's experiencing sanctification. Where is that grace coming from? It's coming from the Holy Spirit. Where is that Immaculate Conception coming from? It's coming from the Holy Spirit. Okay, so when the angel acknowledges her, he's basically acknowledging her as, you are the one in whom the Holy Spirit dwells and acts. Because what happened when sin occurred? We drove out the Holy Spirit. We moved from sanctifying grace, the movement of the Holy Spirit in our lives, to losing the Spirit. That's why Christ at his resurrection, what does he breathe on his apostles? The Spirit. What's he doing? He's saying, I am the last Adam, and you sons and daughters of Adam and Eve have lost sanctifying grace. And I'm breathing it into you. But the angel's saying, Mary, you've already got that breath of your Son, Jesus, before you even have the Son crafted in your womb. You are full of grace. Secondly, love is creation and recreation. What happens as soon as she is acknowledged as having the Spirit? Creation's going on and recreation is. A baby is in her womb. We call that procreation. The baby is in her womb by grace. We call that recreation. So we see the love of God expressed in the sanctification of Mary. We see the love from the Immaculate Conception, by the way. And we see the love of God expressed through her in creation and recreation. And then the love as revelation. What's the angel doing? I have a message for you. I have good news. You're going to be the mom of God's Son. Okay? He's delivering the revelation of God. Things that nobody would have known unless God told it to us directly. Nobody would have known this is going to happen. And this is how God's going to solve all the problem of mankind through a virgin who's going to become a mother and bear the Son of God. And that's what happened, which is good news. Here we go. Experiencing and acknowledging the presence of the Holy Spirit, knowing God. Love is expressed at Mass. We have the same thing. What do we have at Mass? Love is revelation, the Word. The Word is summed up in the Word made flesh, Jesus. We preach the Word at Mass. This is the love of God coming down upon you. Now, sometimes you don't feel like it. You hear the readings, and sometimes they don't seem like the love of God. You know, I've come to divide mother against, it's, what? Is that the love of God? Well, you have to understand it properly. You have Father Jack, homily's going, 25 minutes? Holy moly, is this too much love? I can't take it anymore. Okay? So, I mean, obviously, the love is given to you imperfectly through imperfect instruments, but God has chosen for imperfect instruments to give you his love. Okay? You have to remember this. God's chosen this. Why? Because if we choose to reveal him to others through ourselves, we are perfected. And if you accept that imperfected gift of what we're sharing with you, you're perfected. Because both of us are being humble enough to say we're not God, but we're sharing God. Okay, that's what we do. That's why God sets it up so that he says, I'm going to work through imperfect instruments. You know, the only perfect instrument he works through is his mother. All right? But the rest of us here on earth, we're all imperfect. Those in purgatory, imperfect. Okay? So this is how God works. So he expresses his love, the love as revelation, liturgy, the word, and the homily. Love is creation and recreation. You bring the gifts of bread and wine that you have worked. God has given you grain. God has given you grapes. We take the grain, make it into bread. We take the grapes, make it into wine. Then we give it to God. And then God uses recreation by the power of transubstantiation to make that into his Son. I mean, this is ongoing creation. This is like taking the lowest level of creation and raising it up to the highest possible reality, which is God himself in his Son through the flesh and blood. So this is what happened. It's like, man, we're going to the earth. We're getting this stuff. Then we're making it in by human creativity, making it into something. Then we're giving it back to God the Father. And the Father said, here, I send you my Son. He's such a great God. Can't outdo him. Hey, look, we made bread and wine. Big deal. I'll send you my Son. I mean, that's what he's doing. That's his love. He's loving on us. He's saying, good, you guys aren't being lazy. You're actually working. Good, you're acknowledging me as the source of all the good things you have, and you're cooperating with my completion of all the work of creation as a reflection of me. When you make bread out of grain, you're a reflection of me. When you make wine out of grapes, you're a reflection of me. Now you're looking back at me, and I see your face, and I'm going to give you my Son so that you can see my face. This is how God operates. This is how we have to see this, because this is reality, and reality is ultimately love, because God is love. And then finally, love is sanctification. It's Holy Communion. You've been baptized, sanctified. You've cooperated with that baptism. You're coming forward. If you have venial sins and no mortal sins, those are washed away by Holy Communion. If you have mortal sins, you need to confess them beforehand. You step forward, you receive Holy Communion. What does that do? That nourishes the sanctification of your baptism. That nourishes the sanctification of your reconciliation. That nourishes the gift of confirmation. All of this is being increased. Grace is increased. Okay, so God's increasing that through your cooperation with the power of the Spirit within you. So, experiencing and acknowledging the presence of the Holy Spirit, knowing God. Love is expressed at confirmation. What happens? Love is revelation. Confirmation, you come to Mass, we preach the Word of God, we hear the Word of God, we understand the gift of the Holy Spirit. Love as creation, recreation. We bring oil, which is crushed olives, and we use that oil in an anointing. And what does that anointing do? Be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. You receive the very love of God, which is the Holy Spirit. So again, revelation in the Word. Again, revelation of God's love through creation, which is the oil, and then recreation, which is the grace of being sealed in the gift of the Holy Spirit. Love is sanctification. This is a completion and strengthening of your baptismal grace. You're growing in grace. You're baptized. You're nourished in the Eucharist. You're confirmed in the gift of the Holy Spirit. There's an increase and an overflowing because God cannot be confined. We as human persons are not meant to confine God, but to magnify God. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. We're meant to get over ourselves and beyond ourselves in the Passover of Jesus Christ. That's what we do. And so this is the power that we have. That's a great picture right there. That's awesome. Here we go. Knowing God through the movement of the Spirit. What I would like you to do is I want you to take John, this is the Gospel, 1:10-18, John 1:24-34. And what you're going to see is basically John the Baptist. And John the Baptist says, I didn't even know him. That was to say the Son of God. He talks about knowing. How does he know him? The Father said to me, when you see the Spirit come upon him, then you will know him. He knows him by seeing the dove, representing the Holy Spirit, come upon the Son. He knows him when he sees and experiences the Spirit. You cannot know. When you come to receive communion and I say the body of Christ and you say what? Who is giving you the power to do that? The Holy Spirit. You can only know Jesus in the Holy Spirit. That's it. That's how the Father has ordained. You do not, you have to realize when you're saying that, that's really not you. That's you cooperating with the gift because you're looking at a piece of bread, but you're saying that's the body of Christ. I think Catholics don't understand that power. What are you doing? You know where Jesus is. Guess what? The majority of people don't. They claim to know Jesus, and when he's actually showing up, they don't see him. Do you understand what I'm saying? People do not understand what that gift is. It's like you don't understand. If you actually believe that's Jesus, the Spirit is dwelling in you. You have named God. When you kneel in that Blessed Sacrament chapel, the Spirit is in you because there's no way you would ever do that unless the Spirit were in you and you said, that is God. Does that make sense to you? I don't think we understand the power and gift we have. And if we did understand it, we would be kneeling a lot more and going to communion a lot more. Okay? It is exceptional. It is powerful. It is real. And you know it because you're going like, really? Come on. You can sense that gift of the Holy Spirit. So I want you to read that because if you meditate on these words this week, you're going to go, I never noticed that word know so often at the beginning of John's Gospel. The key is on knowing the Son, knowing him by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what John's talking all about. John cannot say, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world, unless he knows the Spirit. And that's been from the time that John was in the womb of Elizabeth, where Mary spoke in the power of the Holy Spirit. Or how did, remember when they went on the visitation to Simeon the high priest, how was it that he knew it was God? It was the Son of God. By the Spirit. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay. So, I think we miss that a lot of times. The key marks are the movements of God's love in the power of the Holy Spirit. Love, now here, how do you know when somebody's in the Spirit? Like, I have to discern whether somebody's living in the Spirit or not. How do I know it? How do I know I am? Here's what usually happens. Love for and Catholic penetration of Scripture. When people begin to see Scripture from a Catholic vantage, we know the Holy Spirit's moving. Right? When they begin to read, say, flesh and blood, that must be in the Eucharist. We know the Holy Spirit's moving. When they're not seeing that, the Spirit's not moving. Period. You're under... a Catholic vision of Scripture is a sign that the Holy Spirit is a-moving. When people aren't seeing it that way, the Holy Spirit's not uniting in a vision. You don't have a common vision. So love for and Catholic penetration of Scripture reaffirmed in the lives and writings of the saints. My time's up, but I'm going to have to go for just a little bit more. Here's what happens. Think about this. You read something in Scripture, you go, that's awesome. This is incredible, and I'm understanding it's connecting me to Mass, everything else. Then what do? You read a saint who sees it the same way. The saint was living in the power of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't it happen, right? How many of you have been corroborated? You're thinking like, man, I never thought about that before when I looked at the Word of God. The next day you're reading, John of the Cross says the exact same thing. That's how we calibrate. Listen, if I read something and say, man, I think I'm saying this, and then I read John Paul II saying the same thing, I go like, okay, there I am. I'm Catholic. We were united. We were not in the same room. We were not in the same space. We didn't go to the same school or anything. But we saw the same thing in different languages. Exact same thing in the spirit that goes beyond time and space and actually taught us the exact same thing from that same Word of God that could be interpreted many different ways but was interpreted this way. That's power. I mean, it's like, Father, why'd you get so excited about Scripture? Are you kidding me? To actually be looking at something and understanding it with Mother Teresa of Calcutta? Are you kidding me? Come on. Okay, and outside of that, there's no Spirit. Intense attraction to Holy Mass and Eucharistic adoration. How do you know the Holy Spirit's moving? People want to go to Mass, and they want to adore Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. How do you know the Holy Spirit's not moving? They don't want to go to Mass, and they don't want to adore Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. You saying, well, that's kind of simple? I say, yeah, it is simple. God's not complicated. Okay, I can tell when the Spirit's moving or not. If I say, listen, let's go pray before the Blessed Sacrament, they don't want to go. I know the Holy Spirit's not there. But if they say, I would like to go, Father, then I'm seeing the Spirit's moving. How do I know? Because that's what happened to me. I was not going to Mass, and suddenly I was going to Mass. Was that me? That was the Holy Spirit of my confirmation. I didn't even know about Eucharist adoration. I go to seminary, I'm doing it every day for an hour. And I've done it every day since I've been in seminary for my whole life. And somebody said, I think, Father, that's over 8,000 hours. Praise Jesus. I'm serious, on a daily basis, I hunger for that. I long for that. I do that. And there's nothing else. I can't do anything else. That's the Spirit of God. I want to do that. Okay? You say, Spirit, come. I have to desire this. This is a sign of your movement. Holy Mass and Eucharistic adoration with a growing desire for holiness and a life of charity. You begin to go, man, I got to get better. I got to get better. You don't need people to tell you. You know, I get emails all the time, say, Father, you're doing this and that. Say, no, please don't talk to me. I want to be holier. Your criticism, that's fine. But let me tell you something. I know issues you don't even know about, and I want to overcome them. I have a desire to be holy. I may not be holy yet, but I have a desire to be holy. The desire is actually most important. That's the most important thing. Because if you have a good desire and it's holy, God is going to fulfill it. That's how God works. You have a good desire, that's all God needs. He'll work on it. Because believe me, God does not want to keep you from what is a holy desire. So a desire of holiness and a life of charity. Is my holiness not in isolation but in self-giving? Are you wanting to give yourself more and more to everybody you meet? Or are you becoming divisive and reclusive? If you're becoming reclusive and divisive, the Spirit is not in your heart. If everyone you meet, you want them to know Jesus and you want to die for them to know Jesus, the Spirit is in your heart. That's very simple. I want you to remember that. That means anybody, any face you see, anybody. Next, deepening personal relationship with and devotion to Mary. N-O Mary, N-O Jesus. K-N-O-W Mary, K-N-O-W Jesus. Write that down. You'll understand what I'm saying. Look, if you begin to really love Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit's the spouse of Mary, and Mary's the spouse of the Spirit, you can't help but love Mary. A definite sign that the Holy Spirit is working is that people love Mary. And if you don't love Mary and think about her, the Spirit is not moving. I'm just giving this to you because you need to know when the Spirit's operating in somebody else's life and when it's not. Do you understand what I'm saying? Like, I need to know whether I'm communicating with people. Okay, because if I'm not, I'm going like, you know, I'll keep this conversation fairly short and I'll pray about it until we start communicating. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because I only have so much time. So if I'm sitting, okay, this person, all right, here's where they are. All right. You know, one time I met a guy And I said, let's think about this. He says, I don't think. I was like, okay, we're kind of far away here, you know. Okay, so I mean, I'm just saying, you have to pray at that point because the discussion is really kind of useless. Okay, so here we are. I've gone over time. We're moving into the questions. All right, let's move ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Jack. All right, let's go ahead and let's get the questions going. And thank you, Father Jack, for a wonderful, wonderful praxis talk this morning. So let's get into that a little bit deeper. Question number one, how can we call Mary the spouse of the Holy Spirit? Does this teaching contradict our belief that Jesus is the bridegroom of the church, with all the members of the church, of whom Mary is preeminent, living as his bride? So there's your question number one. It's up there on the screens. We got just under 5 minutes to talk about that. Oh, and we have seconds of breakfast as well. So if you're not going to 10 o'clock or 10:30 Mass and you're still hungry, come get some food. But talk about the question too. Good conversation. Let's go ahead and we'll pull up the second question, and you can continue talking about the first question, or you can start leaning into the second question. And the second question this morning, what desire or change in my life reveals the action of the Holy Spirit? So what desire or change in my life reveals the action of the Holy Spirit? So talk about that a little bit, just under 5 minutes. Conversation, everybody. Good job on those questions. Good job with Father Jack this morning with a great talk. A couple of housekeeping notes real quick. If y'all are getting ready to head on out, we're getting ready to go to 10:30 Mass. We're getting ready to go out and enjoy a beautiful Sunday if you've already gone to Mass. Just a reminder, your pitchers, if you want to appoint somebody to dump the pitcher in the kitchen and bring it into the kitchen to help out. Also, the coffee mugs now go in the kitchen as well. So the used coffee mugs, we're washing them in the kitchen. So if you could help us out by bringing them in there and just help your clean up the tables. And if you can stick around and help put up tables and chairs, that would be a great help as well. Now, Ablaze, we're getting ready to finish up our third year of Ablaze. So we're coming up on the end of the third season of Ablaze. And next week, we're going to have the youngest speaker that we've ever had taking the stage, Miss Jessica Baker, up front. Actually going to come up and talk about, she's going to be the witness testimony next week. So as we finish up this section on the Holy Spirit, Jessica Baker is going to be coming up and talking to us. So really looking forward to that. So be sure to be here next week for that. And I think that's it. So I think Dave Markert's back next week. So just remember, when Dave Markert comes in, you have to tell him that Steve was okay, but we missed you. Okay, you have to tell Dave that we love him and we missed him. Okay, we got to keep him up and running. So, Father Jack.
Do we need to enable Dave? Okay, it sounds like that. So, this week, of course, the mental prayer, come Holy Spirit, say that. Maybe say that as a family because it has like responses and so forth, okay? And then the mental prayer, of course. Now, again, I really think that if we do this examination, we'll become much more attuned to the movement of the Holy Spirit in our lives and to the love of God, because that's what that Holy Spirit is. The love of God through his revelation, through sanctification, through observing nature and creation around us, all of that is for us. And so in the mission this week, I really think, again, did I approach the Word of God with the fire of the Holy Spirit in my heart to experience revelation as an expression of God's love. Again, I think it's important to know, if we're not hungering for the Word of God, if we're not hungering for penetration of Scripture, I think it's important to pray for that desire. A lot of times where we need to start to pray is just to have the desire, because we may not have it, okay? We may be broken enough to where, or anxious or discouraged. Sometimes people begin to read Scripture and they get discouraged, and discouragement keeps them from moving forward. Or sometimes they read it and they get anxious because they're misinterpreting it, okay? So you have to realize, no discouragement, okay? No anxiety. Just keep giving everything over to God. And just very gently, because He feeds you the way a parent feeds a child. Not too much, not too little, just what's necessary, okay? And so you have to realize God understands your capacity. God is the one who equips. God is the one who keeps coming to you, pouring into you, okay? So second, did I see God's creation, though fallen and groaning for restoration, with a sense of wonder and gratitude to keep alive the Holy Spirit of love within my heart? We need to get outside. We need to see beauty. And we need to really see beauty in other persons, beauty in all the creative thing God allows us to do in buildings. And I mean, to get outside, to move around, and to acknowledge God as a glorious God, and to acknowledge that God works through us to continue His creation, to complete His creation. You know, so the image I gave you is like going in France and riding on a train into Chartres, and there's fields of grain, and in the midst of the fields of the grain is the beautiful cathedral, and it looks like a ship moving through these waves of grain. What do you see? God's creation, but then God creating through man. That God gives us the stone, God gives us the materials to build this beautiful church in the midst of the beautiful field, set in a way that we can see, riding on a train. You know, it's like all these things are not only God's creation, but God completing His creation through us. We have to understand, what did God put us here to do? Complete His creation, okay? We do good things, beautiful things, and true things, and God's pleased. Remember, if you do a little something, you just work on something, you write a beautiful little few words and stuff, and it never gets published, God's pleased. You done something good, true, and beautiful. I think sometimes we get discouraged because other people don't find out these things we do in secret, but the Father who sees in secret is going, oh, look at my child responding to my Spirit, just playfully doing something creative and good. He's pleased. Okay, it doesn't have to have, we're not utilitarian. It doesn't have to have a specific application. You know, if you just give thanks to God while you're riding your car somewhere, the Father's very pleased. You're acknowledging Him, okay? And it actually increases goodness in the world. It's like you're quote, doing something. Did you even have to do something? Okay, so have I cooperated with God's Word and the inspirations of the Holy Spirit to allow grace to increase in me to make me more like God in thought, word, and deed? How do we do that? Seriously, you have to begin to acknowledge when you're getting discouraged. It's not of God. When you're getting confused, not of God. Getting anxious, not of God. When you identify that, you just turn to God. And he'll lead you from confusion to perspective, from anxiety to peace, from discouragement to encouragement, spirit of encouragement, okay? And sometimes the way he encourages us is very ironic. It's like, are you in pain right now? Yes, Lord. Well, I'm going to give you the strength to endure the pain. Do you not know the answer right now? Lord, I don't know the answer. I'm going to leave you there not knowing the answer. Just as long as you turn to me, you're fine. You see what I'm saying? Like sometimes what he's doing is he's just creating a deeper desire for the answer, and he's humbling us, saying, you're a child, wait. You're a child, wait. You parents, you understand, don't you say that to your children? Wait. Okay, not now, right? You think you turn to God the Father? Wait. But, right, not now. Why not? You're not ready. I'm not, you know, this is not the time for you. This is not when you need to hear this. God does a lot of, makes us wait, makes us stay in suffering, makes us, and why? Because for our benefit, if we understand it's for our happiness, our ultimate happiness, you can endure physical or emotional suffering if you don't know it's perfecting you. Be perfect as your Heavenly Father's, right? So I think for a lot of us, we have to understand, well, why is this happening? Because God loves me. He's permitting it to happen by his permissive will. And then, did I permit the Holy Spirit to make my work today radiant and fruitful? At the end of the day, you should say, did I bring light or darkness? And then, was it fruitful? Can I see some fruits? What happens a lot of times is we begin to look at the tree that's borne no fruit, and that's all we look at, and then we just get discouraged. We need to say, well, wait a minute, where has there been fruit? What's happened that's glorious? If you really look during the day, you're going to see where there's been fruit. Sometimes a difficult day, what's the fruit? I just remained calm. I had peace in my heart, even though everything around me was utter chaos. There's a fruit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the peace that you experience, okay? So I think when we look at fruit, it's not a worldly outcome. A lot of times the fruit is just the way I remained in God during the day despite all odds, you see? Sometimes that's God's perfecting us by not having any observable exterior thing for which we could be given glory, but having interior faith, hope, and charity that only the Father can see. Okay? Sometimes we're there, everyone's misunderstanding us, things to be falling apart and everything, but if you're staying close to God, you're being perfected, okay? Okay, so I think it's important. So let's stand as we finish up today. You know, it's been so wonderful to be able to meditate on the Holy Spirit, because I wouldn't think about half these things unless I was teaching you about the Holy Spirit, so it's fun. Let us pray in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. And Mary, we turn to you, our mother. You're so wonderful. And this year, when we recall the beautiful, wonderful, and troubling at times events of Fatima, we turn to you, ask that you would help us, Mother, to be more penitential, more prayerful, more charitable. So turning to you, Mary, we entrust ourselves to you as your children, and we pray together, Hail Mary. Full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. All right. Thank you very much, Father Jack. Thank you, everybody, for coming out this morning to a place. Again, if you can help out by cleaning up with the water pitchers or the coffee mugs, if you can stick around.